Species go extinct all the time. In fact, it's estimated that more than 99% of all of the species that have been alive during Earth's history are now extinct. An extinction event is when many species go extinct over a very short period of time. And if that event is global and affects many, many groups, we call it a mass extinction. There were three mass extinctions that trilobites experienced. I think one of the most important things that we've learned from the fossil record is that when species are under stress, there are three things they can do. They can either adapt, they can move somewhere new, or they can go extinct. Trilobites have done all three. Trilobites are arthropods, so they're part of the larger group that includes spiders, scorpions, and insects, but they are an entirely extinct group. Trilobites lived from 520 million years ago to 250 million years ago, which means they were around for over 250 million years. That's longer than the dinosaurs were around, if you don't include birds. Oh, well, no, and actually, it's basically the same amount of time if you do include birds. Trilobites were a major component of what we call the Cambrian explosion, or Cambrian radiation. The Cambrian started around 540 million years ago. And before this, there are some fossils, but they're really, really hard to tell what they are. And then during the Cambrian, all of a sudden, we see this huge explosion of diversity. Almost every single living group that we see today, we recognize ancestors in the Cambrian. And it happened over a very short period of time. Of course, by short time, I'm speaking geologically. I mean like 15 million years. But when you're talking about that much diversification, it's really remarkable. Trilobites were marine, which means they lived entirely in the ocean. What we understand about how trilobites lived comes mostly from their preserved exoskeleton that's left behind in the fossil record, as well as traces in rocks that indicate the behavior of trilobites. So we know that they had a bunch of legs that ran the entire length of their body. They spent a lot of time running around the ocean floor, digging through sediment, looking for tasty things to eat, and scavenging wherever they could. Over 22,000 trilobite species have been discovered and named, and we're still finding more every year. Some of them were really bumpy, some of them were really spiny, some of them were really swollen, some of them were really flat, some of them had a lot of segments, some just had a few segments, some had really big eyes, some had very little eyes. They lived everywhere in the ocean. They were in polar regions, tropical regions, shallow water, deep water, water that had lots of nutrients, water that didn't have lots of nutrients. And that makes them really useful for asking questions about biogeography and why species live where they do. During the evolutionary history of trilobites, there were three major mass extinctions: the end Ordovician mass extinction, the end Devonian mass extinction, and the end Permian mass extinction. During the end Ordovician mass extinction, lots of species went extinct, but most families survived and diversified again after the extinction. In contrast, during the Devonian, all but one family went extinct. And then finally at the end Permian, the entire group went extinct. Because every extinction event is different and every species reacts in a different way to environmental stressors, we can get a sense for the probabilities that something would go extinct, but why did that species go extinct during that time period is almost impossible to answer. The fossil record is really important because it's our only way of knowing about organisms that are now completely extinct. In the invertebrate paleontology collections alone, we have over 5 million specimens. Here's a very small trilobite. This is a proeated trilobite from Morocco. They could also get very big. For example, this is a much older trilobite than the little one that we just looked at. But the fossil record isn't complete. Not everything gets preserved, and the stuff that does get preserved isn't preserved completely. And so we have to do a lot of work kind of piecing together these clues from individual beds and then comparing them to other localities to get a more fuller picture of what was living where at what time. We can learn a lot about past ecosystems by simply counting how many different kinds of fossils are at one place. The diversity and the abundance of those organisms will change from place to place and through time. we can also compare the species that are living in those places to see how they changed. So for example, we can count the number of segments in the trilobite body and see how that has changed and why it might have changed. Comparing within groups and between groups and between extinction events becomes so informative. We start to see patterns, and it's by comparing those that we can understand better how environments have changed through time and how species have responded to those changes. Being able to look at specimens like this and compare them with one another is really how we answer fundamental questions about evolution and extinction.